Jonathan, and this is your In the Know. Tonight, we will be having a special choir concert that you do not want to miss. Miss Jennifer is going to be bringing in some incredibly talented musicians, as well as our very own FB First Choir. It's going to be incredible. It's going to be awesome. You don't want to miss this. Kids camp was 2 weeks ago, and the youth just got back from camp this week. Both camps were incredible. Kids were discipled and God was glorified. It was awesome, and be looking for more information about this to come soon. As we start to wind down the summer, we're getting closer to school starting, and we want to invite you and your family to join us August 7th for our Back to School Sunday. At this service, we will be praying over our teachers, administrators, and all of the schools as we begin to start school in the fall. Well, thank you so much. I hope you're following us on all of our social medias. And I'm Jonathan, and this has been your In the Know.
Well, good morning, church. How's everybody doing this morning? We got these new lights up here, and I'm trying to look out and see everybody. Well, you look great this morning. Let's all stand up. We've got a great set of worship, a great message planned for you today. And something I want you to think about as we start worshiping, as we start singing these songs together, think about who we're singing to. Think about who we're singing for. Think about why we're singing. Psalm 150 says, "Let everything that has breath sing praise." Let's all praise the Lord this morning. If you believe that, I want to hear you sing as loud as you can. There's nothing worth singing better than our God.
Our praise awaits you at the dawn. Our souls await to you and lift a song. We've seen the things that you have done, but still we know the best is yet to come. There's more to come.
Yeah.
give the Lord a shout of praise this morning.
Great.
Amen. Yes, lift him up. He is the great I am, the self-existent one, and he can handle each and every issue, problem, hang-up, habit that you or I have today. And so if you're going through something, stop holding on to it. Give it to him. He can take it. He can handle it. He wants to take it and turn it into something beautiful, something that he wants to use in your life. We are so glad that y'all are here worshiping with us today. Real quick, just a couple things, church, I want to update you on. We had youth camp this last week. It was amazing. We had teenagers from all over the state of Florida meeting there at Lake Yale Baptist Conference Center. We sent 42 from our own church and had an absolutely awesome time. And just to update you so you can continue praying and celebrating, we had 8 of our group place their faith in Jesus for the first time. It's amazing. Praise God. You know, those decisions don't just happen at camp. But all year long, we as a church here, we till that ground. We hoe that ground. We're getting ready for God to move. Then when we send him to camp, he has that opportunity. We starve the flesh, we feed the spirit, and the Holy Spirit moves on their hearts. It's amazing. We had 11 decide they want to get baptized, and we're going to be celebrating that. Next week, teenagers, if you want to get baptized, there's going to be a whole line of us up there in the baptistry getting baptized, all right? So teenagers, whether you're at camp or not, you want to get baptized, next week's the time to do it. And we had many other just make decisions, some of them saying they want to pray through going into vocational ministry, some of them just saying they want to rededicate their lives. It was an amazing week. So church, thank you. Y'all are a big part of that. We underwrite a lot of that camp with our weekly giving. So thank you so much for being faithful with that. Real quick, I want to recognize this great group of young people right here from Salt Church. Guys, give us a wave down here, down front. They're involved in the college ministry down there at Salt Church or over there over in Gainesville. And just so thankful for you guys. They got to camp out at Fort Clinch. They came and enjoyed a little bit of the nature here and had a great time just kind of getting ready for the next school year. And we're so excited for you guys and how God's moving in your lives. And I tell you what. Our young people around here, you know, sometimes we get like this negative press and sometimes we deserve it, but it's so good to see a whole group of young people say, you know what, we want to honor God with our lives in our college years on a secular campus, and we're going to make a big difference for the Lord. So we want to be praying for you guys, all right? And so church, commit to pray for this group, for Salt Church. We're so glad that they're here. Real quick, if you are a guest with us, if you're a guest, you're visiting, we want to connect with you. We do that in 2 ways. There's cards there, connection cards. You can fill those out. Later on when you leave, look for the blue boxes all around our campus. That's where we give our tithes and our offerings. But you're our guest, so we don't want any of your money, all right? Now, if you put it in there, we're not taking it out. But we're saying we want to get to know you, all right? So put that card in there so we can get to know you. You can also text Hello First to 97,000. And if you're online, maybe that's how you want to connect with us. We'd love to connect. Let's take a moment right now and let's greet those around us, and then we're going to get back to worship.
Jesus. Now
see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down, raising up the broken to
Let us pray. Let's give a shout to the Lord of praise. Come on. Yeah. A shout of praise to the Lord. All right, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, it doesn't matter how much we clap. It doesn't matter how much we do. God, what matters is that we praise you, that we glorify you, that the things that we do in your name. The things that we do for your glory and for your goodness. God, we could never thank you enough for the things that you've done for us, but that small price to pay, we can give that. We can give everything that we have back to you and to your people, to spread your word and spread your glory, God. And we're just so thankful for that and thankful for you. God, this morning, help us open our minds to receive your word. Help us reflect on what it means to us, God, today, what it means to us going forward, how we can change who we are for your goodness, God. God, be with us this morning and always. In Jesus' name we pray.
If you've got your copy of Scripture, open it up to the book of 1 Thessalonians, chapter 5, and find verse 23 with me this morning. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23. And that'll be kind of a springboard text for us. This series is a little different. We typically work through books of the Bible. First day when school starts back, we'll launch a new study that will be through one of the New Testament books. But this series in the summer, we tend to kind of look at it and go, okay, what are some questions people are asking that need to be tackled biblically? And that's some of the things we've done in this series. So get ready for our next series, probably leaning toward 1 Corinthians at this point. So if you want to read ahead and learn the nature of that book, it would be a good time to do that. For whatever reason, here at First Baptist, we have an abundance of attorneys. We counted at one time, and there were 12, and several, I think, at least 3 to 5 more have joined since then. We've noticed they tend to marry each other. It's a peculiar career path, but we wonder, what is the Lord preparing us for, sending all of these lawyers our way? But nevertheless, they're a great blessing to the church, and one of the blessings is they give me some great material and jokes. So I'm going to read one of those to you this morning. This is a true story of the first place winner in a criminal lawyer award contest. There are criminal lawyer award contests. Happened in Charlotte, North Carolina. A lawyer, do you know the difference between a lawyer and an attorney? There is a difference. A lawyer has graduated from law school. An attorney has passed the bar and is practicing, so that's the difference. This lawyer, young guy, purchased a box of 24 very rare and very expensive cigars and then took out an insurance policy against them for, among other things, fire. Within a month, he had smoked all 24 cigars without having made his first premium payment on the policy that the lawyer had filed, and he filed a claim against the insurance company. And in his claim, the lawyer stated that the cigars were lost in a series of small fires. The insurance company refused to pay, citing the obvious reason that the man had consumed the cigars in a normal fashion. The lawyer sued and won. Delivering the ruling, the judge agreed with the insurance company that the claim was frivolous. However, he also agreed with the lawyer that the insurance company insured the cigars against fire without defining what type of fire was acceptable. Thus, they were obligated to pay the claim. Rather than endure the lengthy and costly appeals process, the insurance company paid the lawyer $15,000 for his loss of the 24 cigars lost in a series of small fires. Afterward, the lawyer cashed his check, and the insurance company had him arrested on 24 counts of arson. Thank you, attorneys. In many ways, life is a series of small fires, and how you respond to those fires makes all the difference in the world as to the quality of life that you will experience. Today, that's what we're talking about. I want you to understand who you are and how God has designed you to respond to stresses, to anxieties, fires that you're going to encounter in this life. Theologians have debated for years something that will sound very boring, but it's essential that I kind of address it at the beginning. Whether you as a human, man or woman, are essentially a dichotomy or trichotomy. The difference is, if you're of the dichotomist camp, you believe that man is essentially two parts, flesh and spirit. If you're of the trichotomist camp, you believe man is three parts, body, soul, and spirit. You say, well, what on earth difference does that make? Well, it makes a lot of difference into how you address issues. The languages don't make the decisions any easier here. The Bible consists of three ancient languages, Hebrew, Greek, and a little bit of Aramaic. They're very different than the English language. Our language is very straightforward, and it's compartmentalized. So if I use a word and use it rightly, you can look at a dictionary and find out what the intended meaning of that word was, as long as I'm speaking with intelligence. The Greeks, the Hebrews, did not trust you so much to just make those determinations based on the context of the conversation. So they had many words to convey the various nuances of meaning that's intended by the writer. So, for example, we're familiar with the idea of love. In the English language, we have one word, love, but in the Hebrew, you've literally got seven or eight. So if we say we're speaking of God's love, it's agape. If we're speaking of brotherly love between siblings or just close acquaintances, friends, it's the word philia. Philadelphia is the city of brotherly love. Romantic love is eros. Friendship is pragma. Family love, storge. Sort of flirtatious love is ludus. And depending on what they're trying to convey to the reader, they will choose the appropriate word. Well, we just use context, right? So if I say, I love my wife, I love my dog, I love Florida Gators, I don't love them all the same way. And the reader has to kind of fill in those intentional gaps based on the subject and the context of the flow of the speech. Well, the same is true. Like, we take all of these different words that the Greeks had for love, and we compartmentalize them into one English word, love. So the essential meaning of the text is still there, but sometimes the beauty is lost of what's trying to be conveyed. The same is true when you speak of a person. Old Testament, New Testament, you see words in the English like soul, spirit, head, mind, heart. In the King James, you have words like ghost and flesh. And what is intended to be conveyed through those is sometimes difficult to discern. And the words are used interchangeably. So the dichotomist take all of the Greek and Hebrew and Aramaic words and reduce them down into spirit and body. The trichotomist sees another division there. Spirit, soul, and body. And I'll unpack what those different words mean. In the Old Testament, the word nephesh is translated as soul sometimes. And sometimes with the same translator, it's translated mind. The word ruah is translated spirit sometimes and soul sometimes. Thus, there is some confusion as to what is being referred to. I am of the trichotomous camp, and I see you and me as existing in essentially three parts. Body, that is the physical. Soul speaks of the mind, the will, and the emotions. And then spirit speaks of that eternal part of you that relates back to God. The key text is 1 Thessalonians 5:23. And I promise you, this is all going, you're going to understand why this is important that you understand as we get into the application, okay? So in verse 23, Paul writes, "Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely and make your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." Three words in the Greek. You have pneuma, it's translated spirit, psuche, translated soul, and soma, translated body. I've already explained what each of the parts mean. Body is physical, soul is your mental capacities, and spirit is the eternal part of you that's made alive at conversion. When Adam and Eve were created, they were fully alive, body, soul, and spirit. In other words, they were perfectly formed humans. They did not experience sickness or death. They had perfect fellowship one with another, naked and unashamed, and they had perfect fellowship with their Creator. They walked with God in the cool of the day. In Genesis 2, remember what God warned. You can eat freely of all of the trees of the garden, but there is a tree in the midst of the garden, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that you shall not eat of it. For the day you eat of it, you shall what? Surely die. Well, you read the text, and they live literally hundreds of years after they ate of the fruit of that tree. So one must ask, in what way did they die? Well, according to a trichotomist, they immediately died spiritually. Their spirit or their mind, will, and emotions were corrupted so that they still understood something of God, but they had been infected by demonic error, and their body would ultimately die. Well, like reproduces like. So if you take an apple seed and you plant it, you're never going to get a banana tree. If you take an apple seed and you plant it, you're not going to get a lemon tree. Like God has ordered it. There's no exceptions. You do it a million times. There's not a percentile where you're going to get a variation of the kind of fruit. And then in the same way, in humanity, like reproduces like. So we have a couple of sinners and they reproduce. They had two children, Cain and Abel. Guess what they were? They were sinners. They were physically, they had a death sentence. Soulishly, they were corrupted. And spiritually, they were dead in need of new life. Then when the gospel comes, Jesus says to Nicodemus, John 3, one of the most familiar passages in the Bible, John 3:16. Well, the context of that was a conversation between Jesus and a rabbi. And he's talking to him and he says, you know, Nick, that's not really how he said it, but he says, you know, you really, your biggest problem is you're spiritually dead. You must be born again. And Nicodemus says, immediately he goes to the physical. Jesus, that's hilarious. That's not possible. Can I enter again into my mother's womb and be born? And Jesus says, that which is flesh is flesh. That which is spirit is spirit. You're referring to a physical birth. I'm not talking to you about your physical birth. I'm talking to you about your spiritual birth. You're spiritually dead, and the only thing you need is spiritual new life. So upon faith in Jesus Christ, our spirit is made alive. We're born again. The most important question probably we could ask today is, have you been born again? And it's very difficult to answer that question in the South. Some of you did not grow up below the Mason-Dixon or east of the Mississippi, but those of us who did, we have many benefits to being in the South, but we also have many dangers of being in the South. Among a very kind of traditional, conservative society, we also have so much gospel around us, sometimes we can be fooled to thinking that it's inside of us. Almost everybody in the South made a religious decision at some point in their journey. You're at Vacation Bible School, they say, how many of you do not want to go to hell? Well, you must be saved now, so let's baptize you. And the interrogative questions were not so robust over the years. And so it's very easy for a person to make a decision and assume that they are a Christian without really asking some hard questions as to whether they have actually been born again. And we'll help you with that in just a moment. But it's incredibly important that you answer, are you alive spiritually, or are you a dead person spiritually trying to do religion well? So the body must die. If Jesus doesn't come back before then, your body has a death sentence on it. Literally, it says in Scripture that the number of your days are written in a book in heaven. Nobody really ever dies early or late. From the time that you were conceived, God has a number, or even before that, a number of days that you're to live upon this earth. That's why David said, teach us to number our days. You say, well, why on earth are we joining health clubs and eating all this food that has no taste to it? I mean, why are we doing that? Well, we do it as well, but we're not doing it to extend the quantity of our life, but rather to improve the quality. If I got 80 years, I want those to be 80 good years where I'm thinking well and I'm active. I don't want them to be miserable years. So the quality of your life can be improved. The physical quality can be improved, but the quantity is set. You have a death sentence on you, an expiration date. Then your spirit. That's the part of you that came alive when you believed in Jesus. When you were spiritually born again, you at that very moment, the moment you exercised faith, you were as saved as you will ever be. Like when you've been in heaven for 10 million years, you're not going to be more saved than you are this very second. That's why Paul said, it's as if you are already seated with Christ in heavenly places. Your spirit doesn't get more or less saved. You're as saved as the Apostle Paul. You're as saved as Billy Graham. And dare I say, you are as saved as Jesus Christ himself, because his righteousness is imputed to your account. So nothing can separate you, therefore, from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus spiritually. You understand? Spiritually, you are perfected upon faith. And your soul is a different matter altogether. Now, I'm referring to soul as your mind, your will, and your emotions. Your soul is fallen and affected by sin, and it must change, and it must change slowly and over time. Paul's referring to that in Romans 12:12 when he says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind." It's what theologians refer to as sanctification. So your spirit is perfect as it'll ever get. Your body will be made perfect when you're raised from the dead, and your mind is being made perfect day by day. Well, how does that work, Pastor? How do I change the way I see, the way I think, the way I feel, my will? How do I change those things? Well, according to 2 Corinthians 10:5, we destroy arguments and every lofty opinion or idea that's raised against the knowledge of God, and take every thought captive to obey Christ. The word picture there is of a centurion soldier with someone he's captured in battle, holding him at spear point, bringing him in subjection to Caesar. You're to do that with every idea, whether it's the ideas you hear from this pulpit or the ideas you see on the news, the ideas you hear at UF, the ideas you hear at Fernandina Beach High School. You're to take every idea and you're to hold it at spear point, bringing it into subjection to Jesus Christ himself. How does that work? Somebody says, "Pastor, you know, I'm not sure I believe everything the Bible talks about. I'm not sure I'm on board with that." I remember when I'm thinking about when I was this age in college, working on my bachelor's or then my master's, and I'm still in school working on my doctorate now. And so with all of these times, I was never a good student. I always struggled. I mean, I was always just grateful to pass the course. And I really figured, because I always thought I gave good answers, really good answers. And so I always thought it must be just over the professor's head, you know. So I had to tone it down to get it on their level. And then I was working on my master's before I learned this. Someone got me, but they were asking a question. The question was something like, "What is the main point of this particular text?" And so I studied it, wrote what I thought the main point of this particular text was, and I got a failing grade on that lesson, on that test. And I said, "But I think I'm right. I don't understand. Why do they give me a bad grade?" And then one of my friends did me a great favor, and they said, "Zach, you didn't understand. You didn't do your homework well. You didn't understand. You didn't read the instructions. You see, the point is not for you to answer that question from your perspective accurately. The point is for you to basically regurgitate what the professor taught you. And as long as you do that, you'll get a passing grade. If you come up with your own ideas, you're not going to get a passing grade. So you got to decide if you're going to pay for this, do you want to pass or not?" Now, I would argue that the point of education ought to be, and some teachers would agree. I have a tendency to demonize my fellow teachers. There are teachers who would agree with this. In high school, middle school, university level, the point should be to teach a kid how to think, not what to think. However, the tendency is that we are teaching our young people what they should think and believe and feel. So I tell my children sometimes, I got two at UF, and I'll say, when you take those tests, here's what you can do. Actually, one of my kids taught me this. She said, the teacher will ask, do you believe that gender is fluid? No. You put that down, you're going to get a failing grade. So what can you put down that lets you not compromise your convictions but still pass the course? And here's what she taught me. She said, what I put down is, the professor taught us that gender is fluid. Gets a passing grade, and she doesn't have to compromise her convictions at the same time. Wish I'd learned that a long time ago. So when people approach biblical reality, biblical truth, we're called to take every thought captive to the obedience of what Scripture says. And some people might say, well, I don't believe what the Bible says. Well, I'm going to do you a big favor if you'll listen to me just for a minute. That makes no difference at all, whether you believe it or not, as to whether or not it's true. It's true. It's true. Not just because I said it's true. I'm telling you, that's a different sermon, but we could unpack why I'm convinced that it's true and believe that it's true. But you say, well, Pastor, I don't believe it. Doesn't matter. Somebody had a bumper sticker that said, God said it, I believe it, that settles it. Listen, God said it, that settles it. Makes no difference whether or not you believe it or not. Now, you can kick against the goads, as God said to Saul, and you can make life really difficult working against the owner's manual of the human body. But it's going to be a rough life for you. And the sooner you look at it and say, look, I don't understand all of it, I just think I'm working on, but I'm going to take the Bible as true, then and only then can you start to make real progress. He says in 2 Corinthians 10:4, the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, the body, but they have divine power, they're spiritual, to destroy strongholds. That's the goal of the enemy, is to get a stronghold in your life. A stronghold is when you go into, you wage war on a city, and you can't take that entire city, but you can get a corner of the city, and you can set up a perimeter, and you can defend against the attacks, and you can own that little spot, that little block of the city is yours. That's what Satan is doing in your heart, is he's gaining strongholds. It may be an area of temptation or struggle. It may be an ideology, a worldview. But he sets up these strongholds, and he defends the perimeter, sets up a hasty defense, and it's his for all practical purposes, unless you're a Christian. If you're a Christian, you have weapons that can tear those down, and you have to learn how to wield those weapons properly. And you say, well, what are they? They're soulish. Let me explain what I'm saying. They are battles that happen on the battlegrounds of ideas, thoughts, words. It's not a riot in the streets. It's a battle of ideas. You see that because of the next verse. We destroy arguments. Arguments against the truth. Every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God. And we take every thought captive to obey Christ. So all of these ideas we've been wrestling with through this series, if you personally struggle with some of these issues and you have some strongholds in your life, or you have family or friends that are struggling with them, understanding how to wage the war in the mind is incredibly important. So with that in mind, let's go through soul, body, and spirit quickly, and let me show you how to address each level. Number one, the soul. I'm referring to your mind, your will, and your emotions. What we have a tendency to do is to assume that every problem is spiritual as a Christian. Some of them are soulish. There have been changes that have taken place. I asked in the early service, I'll do it again here. I grew up in the 80s. My generation are huge consumers right now. So Stranger Things, Cobra Kai, those are appealing to my generation because that's where we grew up. How many of you are children of the 80s? Raise your hand up. Okay. Some of you grew up in the 70s. We have for the 70s to give thanks for disco, maybe? I don't know. How many of you are children of the 70s? Raise your hand up. How many of you are children of the 60s? Those are the ones you got to watch right there. Yeah. And the rest of you, I'm assuming it was like Bible times. But nevertheless, when you're growing up, there is a reason why some of the thoughts and the ideas and the ideologies we've been looking at did not take root in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, or 90s. But suddenly, they're sweeping over the landscape. What changed? The technological and informational revolution. There was a day when I remember my first IBM-compatible computer, personal computer, on a big desk, and I had a dot matrix printer and all the little devices. And if you typed code for like 9 hours, you could make your screen say, Happy Mother's Day. Those were the days. Today, and I had a modem, and with that modem, I could access somewhere around 1,000 books at the Library of Congress, and I thought that was, man, I had an advantage. Today, practically every book ever written, I can access with this. Every word ever spoken in the last 100 years, I can access, or recorded, I could access with this. Every movie ever made, with a phone. Now, with that said, most people who are under the age of, say, 21, all the way down to like 14, when they have computers, when they have phones, they typically spend about 9 hours a day consuming media. They go to bed with the phone at night. The phone is making the laptop or the iPad obsolete. It's everything you need. It's right there. How many of you are using your phone for a Bible? Raise your hand up. See, it's becoming the new norm. With that said, there are gatekeepers of that space. Zuckerberg, Dorsey, Jack Dorsey. And they're not ideological. They have an ideological position. So the content that's streamed to you, they filter in a particular direction. And not to know that, not to be aware of that, and a little bit concerned about that, is foolish. Therefore, what you must learn to do if you're going to partake in this information, you've got to filter some of it yourself and say, I'm not going to let the floodgates just open up so that the world can tell me whatever the world wants to tell me. I'm going to put some filters in place. You must have a strong defense and a strong offense. Your enemy is immensely intelligent. Satan, if you only put up a good offense and say, I'm not going to allow pornography and worldly errors to flood my mind, the enemy would just shift his approach and he'll find a gap in your system every time. Satan is so smart, he makes Einstein look like Gomer Pyle on Valium after an hour on Willie Nelson's tour bus. Now that's a picture for you right there. You'll never outsmart him, but you can try to set up some defenses, set up a perimeter around your mind, guard your thoughts. But you also have to go on the offense and be very intentional about what you're putting in your mind. That's why we give an invitation and say, would you join us? Would you build your life around what's happening here on Sunday mornings? And make it the regular rhythm of your life so that you're intentionally putting yourself under the preaching of God's word week after week after week. Why? Because you're supposed to bring every thought captive to obedience of Christ. And we help you do that. We get in groups here so that you can see how particular ideas apply to your age group and demographic, people going through the same thing you're going through. We respond in worship and in prayer. We give so that all these things can be possible. And it's a huge part of our life. I was passing a guy today. There's nobody who likes to fish more than I like fish. I promise you that. Maybe Bill Dance, but he would be it. I love to fish. And I believe it's okay to fish on Sundays. Don't get me wrong. I'm Sunday evenings. I don't fish on Sunday mornings. Why? Because this is more important than fishing to me. And that's saying a lot. But this is important, and it's important for you. And our men, not as the norm, They don't do that. They plan their life around what's happening at the church. And there used to be a day when most of the community did that. Used to be a day when the coach would call the pastor and see what's going on at the church so he could plan his practices. We need those days back. And the only way those days are going to be back is for you to take church membership very seriously. To put yourself under God's word on the Lord's Day. So, that's how you address the mind, the will, and the emotions. You guard yourself against certain things. You intentionally feed yourself on certain things. Secondly, the body, the physical part of you. As Christians, we are in a great danger. Some of you get this, some of you will have to think through it. But we are in a great danger of assuming that every problem is a spiritual problem. Every problem is a spiritual problem. I would say this, every problem has a spiritual component to it. So you should always respond to pain and struggles, whatever they may be, whether it's relational or physical or whatever, financial. You always take it to the Lord and respond in prayer. But every problem is not at its root spiritual. Sometimes there are physical components that produce the experience you're having. And it's difficult when we're talking about the battleground of ideas because our soul, our thinking, our mind, our will, our emotions happens through the use of our body, an organ in our body called the brain. So the ideas that you're wrestling with, the feelings that you're expressing, emotions, all are formed in a particular part of a physical object behind your skull. So the worlds kind of cross over here. Heard about a family. The dad was really struggling with one of his kids. They were in church every Sunday. They held a biblical worldview. They were discussing the truth and the word each week. And it seemed that while for most of them it was getting them further down the road, one child in particular was really struggling. And the dad didn't know what to do. He was teaching them right. He was had the appropriate discipline for the age. And he didn't know what to do. And so he began to talk to other friends. And he consulted with me. He consulted with counselors, with therapists, with doctors. And most importantly, he really took it to the Lord in prayer. And at some point in the process, he had this insight that he believed God had given him that said, do not treat symptoms the way you treat sins. Now let that sink in for a minute. Because for some of you, that's what you're doing to yourself. Do not treat symptoms like sins. He talked to a Christian psychiatrist, who valued the medical approach but also understood the spiritual component and was rightfully afraid of the medication. And they sat down and they had a discussion and they decided to put this child, who was a teenager, on a very low dose of a particular, if I remember right, it was a norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor. Very small dose. As a matter of fact, the psychiatrist told the father, this probably won't make any difference. It's so small of a dose. But within a few days, that child's personality, it didn't change. It came back to what it used to be. And suddenly, was the kid perfect? Not according to the father. But nevertheless, they had a fair playing field so that they could wrestle with ideas and make decisions and progress in sanctification in a normal way. I began to think through that with so many different issues that I've addressed in church, and I realized sometimes, you know, they come to me because they assume it's a spiritual issue, and sometimes it is, and there's always a spiritual component. And there was a day when I would say, don't touch that medication. There's no good in it. It'll only hurt you. And I would still be very cautious, and I would encourage anybody to be very cautious. And if you have a doctor who's not cautious, you need to maybe think through your doctor. There's a reason why those medications are monitored by the government. They're very dangerous in some ways. However, the mind is the last frontier. We know more about space than we know about our brain. And we don't always know exactly what's taking place. And the science is evolving and they're learning. But there does seem to be some help that medicine can give a person psychologically, mentally. And what I want to encourage you to do is just be open to that if you are struggling in these areas or someone you love is. Talk to a professional. I'm your preacher. I'm not your doctor. But I encourage you to talk to your doctor. Go get with your medical doctor. Go get with a psychologist or psychiatrist and just ask these questions. You say, well, how do you know if it's time? If people who love you come to you and say, it's time, you need to talk to somebody, then go talk to somebody. Don't be so prideful that you think you can handle it. By the way, you don't do that with anything else in your life, do you? I mean, some of you guys, you're taking blood pressure medication, you're taking, you name it, Flomax, you're taking it all. But when it comes down to your brain, oh, I can handle it. Maybe you can't. Why? Because there's a physical component to that. And there are chemicals that cause things to work rightly or wrongly. You can't take a pill to make you suprahuman, but you can take a pill to give you a fair shot. And if you're not operating with a healthy mental apparatus, don't just approach it medically, but don't neglect that at the same time. Learn how to get good advice in those areas. Depression is very real. We're talking about it next week. Anxiety is very real. Addictions are very real. Gender dysphoria is very real. And you don't have to wrestle through them alone. You can get help. Thirdly, your spirit. This is the easiest one. It's the most vital part of you. And thankfully, it's the simplest one to fix. It's only two categories for the spirit, dead or alive. It's all there is. If you're spiritually dead and you're in a religious environment, there's a lot of things that aren't going to seem to work for you. You're going to wonder why we talk about the Bible so much, and you're going to read the Bible. You're going to give it a fair shot. You may even discipline yourself to do it every day. But it's going to read, more like any other book, black ink on white paper, or the blue glow, whichever one you're using. And you're going to read it, and I mean, you're going to enjoy some parts. You're going to be bored with some parts. But once you're alive spiritually, this radically changes. It becomes a sword able to divide soul and spirit, to cut to the inmost parts. It's like it reads you as much as you read it. Your relationship to truth radically changes. It's life-giving. You feel sick when you're not able to be in the Word. You feel healthy when you're in the Word. Your relationship to truth changes. Prayer changes. Apart from spiritual life, prayer's just not a lot different than meditation. It's just a habit, a ritual you go to that may give you a little bit of focus, may make you feel better, but you don't feel like you're literally having a conversation with the Almighty. But in new life, when you're born again, You do. It's different. Not all the time, not on the same level, but you have some times when it really just seems like you can reach out and touch Him. Heaven doesn't seem so far. I want you to have that. I want you to read the Bible that way. But you can't without new life. And for God's sake, God knows the worst thing we could do is to solve all of your problems with truth and you die and go to hell. One of my favorite movies, and I'm real hesitant to even say this because it's not a Christian movie. I don't even know what it's rated. It's not PG, I'm sure. watch it on television where they filter some of the stuff out. But it's an older movie. Analyze This with Robert De Niro and Billy Crystal. How many of you have seen that movie? Raise your hand. Shame on you. Shame on you. In the movie, Robert De Niro is a psychiatrist. Robert De Niro is a gang leader, a mafia boss. Billy Crystal is a psychiatrist. And De Niro's character is having panic attacks, anxiety issues. And so he knows he's got to get some help. So he goes to see Billy Crystal's character, and he clears the room, and he says, "All right, Doc, do what you do." And Billy Crystal says, "Hey, look, I'm a busy man. I don't have time to take a new patient on. And even if I did, what am I supposed to do? Make you a happy and well-adjusted gangster?" And here's what I'm saying. I think about that a lot because I need to remember the fact that I am not supposed to make you a happy, well-adjusted person on a path to hell and eternal judgment. The most important, essential part of what we do here on a Sunday is introduce you to Jesus Christ. It's to bring you to a point, a crossroads, to where you have to decide about Jesus, about the gospel. Have you ever had that happen? A time when you looked at yourself and you said, "Look, I agree with him, with what God says. I'm a sinner, and I deserve rightfully judgment. But I also believe what God says, that he sent Jesus, his son, and he took all of my sin upon himself. He hung there between heaven and earth, and he absorbed the wrath of God for me. And then he said, 'It is finished.' He was buried in a borrowed tomb, and 3 days later, God raised him from the dead, and he's alive today, and he's coming back to judge us." And so I look at that and I say, I believe that with all of my heart. In that very moment, it's like splitting a hair to know how this happens. The two things are almost inseparable to know which comes before the other. But in that very moment, you are regenerate. You're born from above. Some say the sinner's prayer is like a birth cry of regeneration. It's in that moment, you're born again, and then you say, "Oh, Lord, save me." I think when you say that, he's saying, "I already have." The moment you exercise faith in your spirit, in that moment, you are alive. Has that happened? Does that ring a bell? Do you go, "Yeah, man, I wouldn't have said it that way, but I know what he's talking about." Or do you go, "I don't have a clue what he's talking about"? And if you look at it today, and if you're just a religious person trying to do the right thing, I love you. I've been there. Man, I've been down that road. But you'll die and go to hell if you don't know Jesus. And we want to warn you of that today and let you meet him. In just a moment, I'm going to pray a short prayer. When I say amen, that's your signal. If God's dealing with you about that, that's really good news. If he's not dealing with you about that and you're not saved, that's scary. But if you are concerned and you're wanting to get it right, then in just a moment, our pastors are going to come down here to the front, and they want to just have a conversation with you and show you what the Bible says, pray with you. As soon as I say amen, if you want to come, talk to them about your salvation, then you come at that time. If you're here and you say, "Pastor, I know I need to be, I mean, I know I'm saved, I've been saved, but I'm not a vital, faithful. I don't build my life around the gathering of the local church the way I ought to and put myself under God's ideas." And you say, "Today, I'm recognizing that I need to unite with a family of faith." If that's the case, you too, you come. Bring your family. Maybe a husband, as we pray, would just take a wife by the hand and say, "Let's do this." We would be honored. We pray weekly that God would send people like you our way. And if he's doing that, our doors are wide open, okay? Let's bow our head and close our eyes. Father, we thank you for this day and for your kindness to us. Lord, I hope this complicated subject matter, Lord, that you will distill it down. And Father, help people to understand who they are and how they change. God, there are those today that you've convicted of sin and righteousness and judgment. through the Holy Spirit, you're drawing them to faith. God, would you give them eyes to see and ears to hear? Do what only you can do. Lord, will they respond in faith, which is also your gift? And Father, for those that are in need of a tribe, a family, a home, I understand sometimes we don't always understand denominations, and God, I pray that wouldn't let anybody become a stumbling block to anybody. But Father, may they know that this is a tribe of people, a group of people, a city within a city who believes the Word of God is true. And we seek to build our church on that truth in our lives. And if they resonate with that statement, God, may they come. Thank you, Lord, for this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand to our feet. If God's drawing you, you come.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed.
Well, amen. I never understand why it seems like all the people that want to join or get saved either goes to Frank or Dan or Josh. One day when y'all want to join the church, you just be determined. I'm going to let Pastor Zach pray with me, all right? I'm just picking on you guys. But yeah, man, it's so good to see people just doing the next right thing. God tells them to do something, just following through. They'll never regret that. You know, you regret a lot of things you do in life. You never regret just obeying the Lord. Amen? Amen. We're going to close the service. I'm going to make my way back to the lobby area with my wife. If we hadn't had a chance to meet you in person yet, and thank you for worshiping with us. We would love that opportunity. So just give me a couple minutes, stop by there on your way out, and let us just say thank you and meet you. We would love that opportunity before you leave today. Pastor Dan, you come close us out as you see fit.
Amen, amen. Pastor, before you go too far, if you would stay for a moment, Ms. Julie, our deacons have a quick presentation that they would like to make. This is Jason Shear and his wife Julie and John as well. And I'm going to do a very risky thing and hand the microphone to our deacon chairman.
Well, Dan, I didn't take full advantage of this in the first service, so I'm going to now. So there's something I got to get off my chest. No, I'm just joking. So in the scripture, just ahead of the passage that Brother Zach preached on, I wanted to share Paul's advice to the church at Thessalonica. It says, "Dear brothers and sisters, honor those who are your leaders in the Lord's work. They work hard among you and give you spiritual guidance. Show them the greatest respect and wholehearted love because of their work." So this morning we'd like to do that. You may not be aware, but we celebrate this month Brother Zach's 5-year anniversary with here at First Baptist Church. So. And as a small token of our appreciation, we just wanted to present you with something that I thought you'd get some good use out of, since we know how much you like to fish. So thank you so much, and we appreciate everything that y'all have done.
Thank you, brother. I appreciate it. Bless y'all. Thank y'all so much. It is the joy of our life to just be a member here. I mean, this is the healthiest church we've ever been a part of. And it's a joy to pastor this church. And just thank you. Just, you know, as long as you'll let me do it, I'll do it, all right? And this is not an El Cheapo, all right? This is a nice one. And so we're going to put it to good use. Thank you very much. And let's keep on catching fish and catching souls for the glory of God. Amen? Amen. Thank you.
Amen, amen. Let me make a few quick announcements and then we'll all be dismissed together. Of course, come back tonight for our choir concert. They have been working hard for what seems like years on some of these specials, and they just felt like, hey, let's have an opportunity where let's just come together as a church, both of our services, and just worship together. And so tonight will be a special night of worship. Also, we have a beach baptism this afternoon at 3 o'clock at Peters Point Beach. We want you to join us as we celebrate those getting baptized, or if you want to get baptized, catch one of the pastors after service and we'll give you instructions on how to get plugged into that as well. Let's pray and then we'll be dismissed. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you again for today. Thank you for Pastor Zach and Miss Julie. Thank you for their ministry here. Thank you for all they do in and through this church. Lord, I just pray that you would continue to strengthen, guide, direct, give them wisdom, give them energy. Lord, give them everything that they stand in need of as they go about doing the work of serving this congregation. Lord, I pray for many, many more years, that as a church and as a pastor that we can be joined together doing the work that you've called us here to do. Lord, again, thank you for blessing this church. Thank you for continuing to use this church as a lighthouse in this community. Lord, see us as we leave this place and help us always to give you the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.